the Judean desert, one of the earliest cradles of civilization. And one thing that all civilizations here had in abundance is this. Sand, an oxide of silicon. So how is it that we have come to live in an age of silicon? Well, the answer partly lies with this. The wisdom of dozens of Nobel Prizes is embodied in this little box. But the primary material that makes this possible is actually silicon. So without the silicon in this ancient form, this doesn't exist either.
So we're trying to learn from nature, which had a long time to evolve and use it in other contexts.
We have a treasure trove of hundreds of millions of years of evolution to derive from principles that we cannot even fathom.
Materials are central to all of our work in energy and sustainability.
In my lab, we work with materials, but at the atomic scale. Quantum mechanics really rule the properties of materials.
I love looking at things and thinking at them at the atomic level.
And maybe later we can apply it to other systems.
To find the materials that we need for the future.
If we think about the Stone Age, the Bronze Age, or the Iron Age, what really tells one apart from the next is the use of a different kind of material. What started out as basic human curiosity about the materials that surrounded us ended up being a major driver for the progress of humanity.
Because every time we find something, there are more new things that we don't understand.
And this is what the Center for Advanced and Intelligent Materials is. It's about human curiosity about materials, both natural and man-made, and who knows where that curiosity may lead us in the future.
Things that fascinated me most the last few years are different types of mechanisms that organisms evolve to manipulate light. Trees get their energy through their leaves. So the leaves evolve these calcified deposits that collect the light and scatter it to optimize the yield of photosynthesis. The cones of the scattering cover all the internal layer of the leaf, so it can reach each chloroplast that are responsible for transforming the light energy into materials that can be used. In the right conditions, it maybe can double the efficiency of the light that is exploited.
Here we are in the main workshop of the Weizmann Institute. And here I'm holding an artificial joint. It can rotate in most ways. And from the way I'm struggling to rotate it, the friction here is pretty high. This is in great contrast to the sort of friction we have in our own joints, which is wonderfully low at even very high pressures. What enables this is the cartilage that coats the ends of our joint bones. There is no man-made material that can even approach it in terms of its low friction at very high pressures. So we're trying to come up with new materials and use it in other contexts.
Even if you were born 100 years ago, you would recognize this battery, the lead acid battery that is powering this golf cart. It's very heavy, it's very inefficient, and it's just not good enough for what we need in electric vehicles today. Surely, there must be something better than this. So actually, there is something better, and you all own it. It's the lithium ion battery that is charging our cell phones and our laptops. This is also the technology that is charging modern electric vehicles. But even with lithium-ion batteries, we are still not where we want to be. What we are doing is we are using a very similar technique to MRI to look inside the battery, understand what happens at the atomic and molecular level. I want to understand what happens if we change one atom out of a million. What happens when we put a certain nanometric size layer to the material, and we just don't have the methods to answer that now. So I want to develop the methods to do that.
The Claw Garden is a playground for children that would like to experience science. And in a way, my lab is exactly the same. We enjoy playing with science. We are looking for the next big jump that will take us to a completely new era of materials and the things that we can do with these materials.
Behind me is the most visible example of Weizmann Institute of Science's long-term interest in fundamental research in energy and sustainability, an area that was very active in the 80s and early 90s. And we have had some fantastic surprises from fundamental research in solar cells. A class of materials that we never thought would be good for anything turns out to be an amazing material for energy conversion. This is the nature of fundamental research. If we don't do that, we'll never find new things.
In science, it is very important to communicate, to share ideas, and new building will actually serve this purpose.
And we'll bring together the best researchers and the most modern facilities to do the best science that we can.
We know how to ask questions, and we know how to look for answers, but we never know what the answer will be.